What is your greatest fear in life? And I'm not talking about spiders or heights. I'm talking about in the depths of your life. What is the greatest fear in your life? Is anybody vulnerable enough to share?
To be left alone.
To be left alone.
Yeah.
We're getting unanimous consent.
Loss of friends.
Loss of family.
Loss of your wife, being left by yourself.
Yeah.
Loss of family.
Yeah. Any others?
Good health.
Loss of health. Great news in your
health.
Yeah.
Then happiness and health of my children.
Okay, concern for your well-being of your children.
Loss of memory.
Loss of memory. Wow. What did she say? Well, loss of memory. That's right. Well, all these losses are so significant to us, and it is about a sense of being alone or being abandoned or being without that which will help us remember who we are, remember that we are in relationship and need each other. Well, that's exactly what the Gospel of John passage is about this morning. In the life and the death narrative of John's telling of the Gospel, it is slanted in this emphasis on Jesus trying to prepare the disciples for what is called his departure, his death, his absence from being among the disciples, and his leadership role as they hung to his every word and followed him all those days of their ministry together. He's been telling them he's going away, and now they're wondering, what will it be for us after he's gone? What is the next part of the story? What happens to us when Jesus is gone? Well, we know this story. We play it over and over again. We tell about how the mother bird throws the birds out of the babies out of the nest so that they'll fly on their own, hoping that they won't go to the ground and become vulnerable to prey. Hopefully, they have taught the bird how to fly on its own. We know that every teacher knows that what their task is to be able to help the student get the knowledge that they need, the skill sets they need, so that they can go out into the world, defend for themselves, but also they have the tools necessary not merely to survive, not to thrive, but to excel, to use all of their gifts to the betterment of the larger community. Every parent knows that the responsibility we have is to equip their child or children with the life learning skills and experiences to take responsibility for their own future. I can remember, maybe you've been through that too, I'm sure, when you take your child to college and you leave them there. That sense of, have I done everything necessary? This letting go is not easy. And I think maybe our children, after we drove away, felt that the letting go was part for them to do as well. It's always about filling and letting go. Yes, this is one more cycle constant in our lives. Forming and building relationships and then letting go. To begin that process, though, all over again. It is the cycle of beginning a new chapter in our lives, filling the pages with all kinds of learnings and experiences, and then at some point, beginning it to point to closure that comes either by choice or incident, or even by accident, planned or unplanned. When we find ourselves at that place that we do have to turn the page, begin writing the new text, or that next chapter in our lives. Well, such is the flow of the gospel narrative before us. Such is the flow of our lives as disciples in the church in each new day and each new age. As I stated earlier, the real-time context of this passage in John is near the end of the first century, that time known as the parting of the ways between the Jewish community and the Christian Jewish community. The Christians would not have the prior support that they had of the synagogues. In fact, their relationship would be one of hostility over many years. Nor would they have the their support of the Roman Empire around them, who understood who the Jews were, but they weren't quite sure what this new crazy sect called Christians were all about. It was true that this body was so small that they were a minority religious sect without power or knowledge by the greater world. They were on their own to begin again to write a new chapter. And so the fledgling Christians were feeling the weight of their impending isolation. They knew they had to go forward, but how would they do it? They wondered in their hearts and aloud, can we do this on our own? Today, more and more, the Christian community is becoming a minority again. At least to those who are actively present and engaged in a worshiping, serving community. Many people would identify themselves as Christians, but maybe simply be occasional fans of Jesus when it's self-serving and feels good. But find it difficult to take the deeper steps of commitment, living each day in terms of Christ's call to love Jesus, by keeping his word with passionate fidelity to each other in relationship with our loving and just God. Living an active and intentional life of faith is not for the faint-hearted. The challenges of faith and action remain for us most challenging again in our day. And so to those who are fearful of trusting God that much, those who feel alone even in a crowd, to those who wonder what the next chapter of our life as a church or congregation is going to look like, or how we get started in writing the next chapter, we find our best counsel in these words from the Gospel of John. First, we hear one more nuanced reference to the fact that we are to love each other just as Jesus has loved us. Those, he says, who love me will keep my word, what I've been about. They will take my word seriously. Those who seek godly change in their lives, those who seek God's righteousness and justice in the world, will be those who keep Jesus' word, obeying his message, following his vision, fulfilling his mission of liberation, peace, and justice for all, beginning with the least among us. I believe that when Jesus says to keep his word, it's not merely about holding on to it, nor is it to put it on a shelf, nor keep it for safekeeping in a curio cabinet. But it means to live and share and expand the word of grace and generosity into the lexicon and relationships of our lives. Keep alive and active the word of God. So after he calls us to keep the word, Jesus does provide us ways to do so, beginning to sustain our life together in the story of God. Jesus provides us with these powerful tools of presence, peace, and perseverance. The presence of God always being with us. God in Christ says comes to make a home with us. And so we may need to look in our home. Where is God in the midst of the home where we live? But also, where is God in the midst of this house, this home of prayer and gathering for us? So we will know that no matter what happens in our lives, all the fears that we hold are met and matched by the God who continues to be present to us. There is nowhere that we can go that we are not in the holy presence of God. We hear the psalmist say, if I go to the highest mountain or the deepest depths of Sheol, if I fly to the point of sunrise, you would still be there holding me in your presence. We know that we are always in the holy presence of God. We are never alone, even when we feel lonely. It's not only a holy presence to remind us to appreciate the gift of each new day, but it is an active, engaging presence. We're taking time to pay attention to God among us. Jesus says the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, will teach us everything and remind us, even when we're losing our memory, remind we belong. Last weekend at our leadership retreat, we invited a spiritual director, Reverend Bill Cooley, to lead us in some tools for passionate spirituality, how to grow in that area of our lives. And one of the things, the points that he made was, as we make appointments in our life every day for the things that we're going to do, we need to make an appointment for a conversation with God. We need to make time that we not only communicate with God who we are, but that we make enough time for silence to sit and to listen what God might be trying to say to each of us. Remember, we are always in the holy presence of God. The second tool is that of peace. Jesus says to us, "Our peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you." But we know there are a couple different ways of hearing that word peace. There are the outward expressions of peace. Our ministry we've been given in Christ of reconciliation and forgiveness. Our call to the deep love of loving our enemies. Of never resorting to revenge or violence. Of never returning evil for evil. Or responding to evil by doing good. But peace also does refer to that inner tranquility, that safe place of calm and rest and assurance, even in the midst of turmoil and conflict and defeat or failure. As the choir sang this morning, out of oneness in God and with each other. A peace that knows that no matter what happens to us, there is no one or no thing that can take away our value or our worth in the eyes of our God. But Jesus says, "I give you my peace not as the world gives." What's up with that? I think Jesus was referring to what was known in that day as the Pax Romana, or the Peace of Rome. It was a peace that was maintained by domination and control. Rome held all the authority, all the power over people's lives. And as long as you behaved yourself, you got to live another day. They called that peace, but that's not what Jesus understood as peace. The peace of Christ is the peace that holds us secure, even when the world appears to be falling apart all around us. It is the peace that enabled Nelson Mandela to suffer the torture and imprisonment of South Africa's evil apartheid political system. Peace that was able to withstand the horrific slander and physical abuse that the empire perpetrated in the name of keeping the peace by law and order. Peace I leave, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Yes, Christ's peace is that peace that passes all understanding, known by those who have made that leap of faith into the arms of God. We hear it in Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane when he said, "Not my will, O Lord, but your will be done." Those words from the cross when he said, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." Peace comes when we let go and we let God lead. Presence, peace, and perseverance. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Neither let them be afraid. Resignation is not a stance that disciples can take in the world. Rather, nonviolent resistance is the way that word is kept by followers. In our great hymn, "God of Grace and God of Glory," there is this line, "Save us from weak resignation to the evils we deplore. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, serving thee whom we adore." The absence of poverty and greed, the absence of war and violence, the absence of privilege for the few, the absence of prejudice and fear, the absence of hate and malice toward envy, the absence of religious bigotry or spiritual terrorism is what Christians are meant to be about. So don't let your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid when we go and we live into this higher call. Now, we can't stop people from doing harm to us, but we can choose through Christ not to harm others. Or as the Council of Romans, which we read together, said, we are to get the best of evil by doing good. Let's stand then in unity, in one, for and with each other in this obedience to the one who commands us to love and equips us with these powerful tools of presence, peace, and perseverance. May it be so among us.